Okay, welcome to the Institute for Policy Studies and our briefing, Cameroon's Internet Refugees. The Institute, my name is Nkafu Policy Institute. I'm the events coordinator at the Institute for Policy Studies. I also do a little bit of analyst work here and have an affinity for everything African. And so the Institute for Policy Studies, just to tell you a little bit about us, we're a multi-issue think tank that's progressive and does a lot of work around policy research and works with advocates and activists and social movements to mitigate the effects of military power and corporate influence. And we try to leverage things around economic justice, all sorts of social justice. We are very honored to be hosting this briefing here because we think that Africa is a very pivotal place in the world, obviously, we know. And we want to be able to contribute to the movements on the ground, the people's movements on the ground in Cameroon and Africa that are struggling for social justice. And so that's why we're very honored to have this this event. We're going to be going for, we're starting a little bit late, so we've cut into our time. I'm not sure how much we will be able to go over time, but just to tell you a little bit about how we'll go, we're going to, you know, this is part of my opening statement and welcome, but then we're going to have 5-minute opening statements by each panelist, and then a short Q&A dialogue between myself and the panelists, and then we're going to open the floor for people to contribute. I'm fond of saying that it's not just a Q&A, it's also comments. We welcome comments as well because we know that we can learn from the dialogue from everyone that has something valuable to share. Let's just make sure we try to be concise and brief. And then at the end of that session, that dialogue, we're going to have closing statements by the panelists, each about 5 minutes. And hopefully we won't run too much over time. I'm going to start with saying, well, the West African nation of Cameroon is experiencing political unrest throughout large swaths of the country. And since last year, there have been several demonstrations and boycotts by Southern Cameroonians to protest well-documented language and regional discrimination. Cameroon is a federated country that is split between the majority Francophone, French-speaking, and the minority Anglophone, English-speaking populations. It was first colonized by the Germans in 1914, but following World War I, the colony was transferred to British and French control. And so a whole lot of things have transpired since then. As we all know that Africa has gone through a sweeping independence movement that was during the 50s and the 60s and really actually leading all the way up into the 80s and some say the 90s, struggling to find its own way through a movement for African unity and also just political independence and going through, you know, the neoliberal programs really see sweeping the world that have, I would say, wreaking havoc around the world. And so a lot of these things are the root causes of any place in the world that we can look at that's having turmoil. And so we're going to have our 4 esteemed panelists tease out some of these things as they relate to Cameroon in particular, and I'm going to introduce them and let them start with their opening statements. We have Dr. Denis Foretia MD, who is a co-chair of the Denis and Lenora Foretia Foundation and senior fellow at the Nkafu Policy Institute, a leading Cameroonian think tank. He's a faculty in the Department of Surgery at Johns Hopkins University and a staff acute care surgeon at Lifebridge Health in Baltimore. We also have Harmony Bobga Mbuton, recently fled to the U.S. from imminent political arrests and was the president of the Lawyers Association in 2 of the Anglophone regions of Cameroon. He's also representing Cameroon Common Law Bar Association. We also have Dr. Ikome Sako,
yes,
is the also president. Founder, President Emeritus of the Community Humanitarian Emergency Board, an organization working in crisis fields in Cameroon and Central African Republic. And last but not least is Adryan, Wallace, who's an organizer with Pan-African Community Action, PACA, who is co-sponsoring this briefing with us, along with Global Partnership for African Development. And Adryan is also a professor of politics, economics, and international studies, and director of the Africana Studies Program at the University of Hartford. Panelists, thank you for coming and welcome. And maybe, I guess, we could go down the line with statements. Mm-hmm. So you want to start with Carmen?
You want to start?
Yeah, let's with that. I was being told that.
Okay, you've given a bit about the history of Cameroon, how we came to this point. And I may just need to add a bit on it. Cameroon actually is misunderstood from the outside because everybody thinks that that is a federated state, but it is not. And the problem started from the day, the eve of independence of Southern Cameroon. Because on the 30th of September, the projected date of independence was 1st October 1961. The other part of Cameroon had already become independent on the 1st of January 1960. On that eve of independence, something dramatic took place, and the British ambassador to newly independent Cameroon virtually handed the sovereignty of Southern Cameroon to President Ahmadou Ahidjo, the President of the Republic of Cameroon, in the presence of John Gufonche, who was the Prime Minister and Head of Government of Southern Cameroon. So at the time, it was daybreak on the 1st. We were not independent and therefore not cloth politically to carry out any negotiation to establish a federation. And the whole drama in Fumban ended up with us not having a conclusive disposition for establishing what I have called an act of union by way of a federal constitution. In fact, Ahidjo apologetically told the National Assembly of his country that they were not going into any serious federal arrangement. They were simply recovering part of their territory per the German protectorate. And this unwritten policy has determined the disenchantment of Southern Cameroonians that has finally blown up in recent months. And the consequence has been that people have gone back into history and seen how we have been agitating under the false impression that we're in a federation when we were not. And the moment the government of the Republic of Cameroon realized that the international community's attention could be drawn to the reality of what has been going on in Cameroon for the last 55 years, they decided to take the whole management of the crisis into camera. They shut down the internet, ostensibly to foreclose access to the things that were happening and the information that, you know, could inform the international community. We had a lot of entry points because we suddenly realized as lawyers that almost every area had been compromised. The last of them were the area of law. So we saw in 2016, from 2015, an accelerated process of compromising the common law. So in 2016, we launched, in fact, I mooted the idea that we should have a common law conference on the security of the common law within the Cameroon polity. And the outcome of it were some very far-reaching resolutions that we tabled to government, to asking them to stop the erosion of the common law and to backroll what had already been eroded. But more importantly, we suggested that they have to go back to the inconclusive arrangements in Fumban and establish a reliable federal structure foundation for the country, because that was the only way we thought there could be a sustenance of the any security measures for preserving the common law. This came to pass, and we witnessed government's reluctance to respond to us. After that, those resolutions were served. We went on to another conference where we did a reminder. And then on the 12th of July, I noticed that the government was, you know, adamant about responding to us. So I filed a petition before the Constitutional Council asking for a determination whether or not there ever existed any act of union between Southern Cameroon and the Republic of Cameroon. This has been ignored to this moment that we speak. So the rest of the details, we will get into it when this conversation takes off. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me introduce the country we call Southern Cameroon. That is, some will prefer to call it Ambazonia. Probably you've been doing some research here, so you saw the name Ambazonia, which was suggested by one of our freedom fighters and the nationalists. So this country, or this part of the country called Cameroon now, measures 43,000 square kilometers with a population of approximately 8 million. So this, as you can see, is larger than the state of Hawaii, Massachusetts, New Jersey, Vermont, or Delaware. It is larger in territory than the following European countries. It's larger than the Netherlands, it's larger than Denmark, it's larger than Switzerland, Belgium, Turkey, Luxembourg, etc. So the population of Southern Cameroon is bigger than Finland, Hong Kong, Singapore, Jordan, Kuwait, and is approximately as big as Switzerland, Austria, or Paraguay, or Israel. So it's not a small country. So it is supposed to be ranked the 93rd largest country in the world. So we are not just some negligible piece of land, as these people we popularly call them La Republic, they are oppressors, how they want to tame us. So I would like to make a brief rundown of the blunders, the things that happened that brought us to this place. So I have 5 minutes. There's no way I can give you any details more than an outline. Our problem started, first of all, from blunders that were done at the level of the United Nations, because we were a trust territory. That means under the supervision of the United Nations. And there was a resolution that was mandated the trustees to prepare our territory for independence or self-government. And when it came to our case, we were not given the opportunity like any other trust territory to be, because we had already exercised self-government from 1953 to 1960, we were exercising self-government. So, but we were not given, all what was needed logically was to prepare our documents and present them to the United Nations for our independence. That did not happen. So they gave us, that's why I said the first blunder was by the United Nations. They gave us three options. They give us two options, rather, that we'll get independent only by joining. And I would drift to say that Britain was not interested in a little piece of land that we had not discovered any minerals in it. So they gave us the options of becoming independent by joining Nigeria or our brothers or cousins of La République de Cameroun, who had become independent a year before. So, and to tell you that it was a plebiscite, not a referendum. The choice was through a plebiscite and not a referendum. And we should know that is significant, because a referendum is a perjury confirmation of the result of the question. But with a plebiscite, it was just a consultation. It was just an intention. They wanted to know our intention only. So we did not become legally bound by a plebiscite. So there was a different... I'm almost done. Okay. I'm sure we may probably come to this, but one more minute. So that is the greatest blunder. And then when... and so there was the act of April 21st, which was the 1608 resolution, 1608, that was on Southern Cameroon. That prescribed the things that needed to be done before October 1st, 1961, for the union to take place. So that was the most important law that brought us together, because we expressed an intention through the plebiscite, but that was not a union. So, but the problem is that this resolution 1608, our republic who wanted to join with us even voted against it. Our people who want to join with us, they voted against it. And that was the law that prescribed the thing that needed to be done for that union to be legalized. And those things were not done. So we're supposed to attain independence by joining. So the joining did not take place since the resolution. What was supposed to be done, including the Act of Union, was never done. So, you see, it has been a lie throughout. And that lie led to a lot of things, a lot of neglect, a lot of marginalization, further constitutional blunders and exploitation. And that's where we are. We have been fighting. Somebody will say, why now? We've been fighting. We have gone through the underground stage. We came out, tried to see how to change the system so that it can work for us. We tried severally, we failed. And this time I think the cup is full. We started with the teachers, with the lawyers, and then the teachers joined, and then the street, people on the street, the spirit was reawakened and the fight continues.
So I will focus my introductory remarks on the ways in which we can look at the current situation in Cameroon, including the internet blackouts and the recent, as my co-panelists mentioned, the recent strike of the teachers and lawyers associations, as speaking to the broader issues of marginalization that not only people in Cameroon that predominantly speak English are experiencing, but the fundamental inability of the state to really represent everyone's collective interests, right? Because there are certainly people that are in other parts of Cameroon where the majority of those individuals also speak French that feel economic marginalization as well, right? So there are particular ways in which this idea of language, particularly colonial languages, have been linked to politicizing identity and then using that idea of being Anglophone or Francophone to frame a discussion which should really be about equal resource distribution, right? And so it becomes a strategy for the state in some ways, I would argue, to consolidate power and to avoid additional critiques and to undermine solidarity movements across different identity categories, right? Because if the state can frame this as an issue that's just specifically only targeting or only impacting people in the north and southwestern part of the country, then it means that specifically when you look demographically, a minority segment of the population is experiencing this marginalization. But if it can be broadened to include everyone that's dealing with these socioeconomic differences and disparities in education and income, et cetera, then it becomes more of a grassroots movement about political inclusion, which the government, of course, would not necessarily be interested in having that discussion if their goal is to maintain power. And particularly when we start to look historically, if we think about Felix Mumet's mobilization efforts toward independence, and unfortunately his eventual assassination, at one point he actually sought refuge through the Anglophone part of Cameroon, right? So in that context, during that period, the ways in which linguistic heritage and expression were politicized in terms of identity is very different than what we're seeing now currently. You know, Mume really also pushed this idea of a federation, which again, my colleague mentioned, which Ahito pretty much shut down any discussions of having a federated Cameroon back in 1972, right? And then, of course, his successor, Biya, continued with this idea of having a united republic. And so by removing this discussion of really substantively instituting a federated system, which would help deal with those issues of inclusion and representation, by silencing kind of that structural change in the government, it also gave the current administration a political advantage so that they could consolidate power and really quell dissent. The internet blackout, again, if we want to discuss that, which has primarily affected people that are in the predominantly English-speaking portions of Cameroon. You know, lots of bloggers have been traveling to Douala and other parts of Cameroon, so they do have internet access, right? And they've been talking about the ways in which, because they've been most vocal of the state, because they've been most critical, again, it's political targeting under the guise of, under the mask of only focusing on folks that predominantly speak English in the country. And so I would just argue that as we're discussing and unpacking all of the political and economic and social implications of the conflict in Cameroon, that we remember that this is fundamentally about resource distribution, right? And that is the more divided the masses of people in Cameroon become, and the state really wants to perpetuate this narrative, not people necessarily on the ground, because many of them, even individuals that are especially youth that are mobilizing, and again, thinking about social media and bloggers, those individuals have also highlighted that they have counterparts. They have in the French-speaking parts of Cameroon, that they see parallels in terms of this disenfranchisement and its broader implications. And so the efforts of the state are to undermine those solidarity moments, because then it allows them to be able to push back any discussions about really inclusive or substantive democracy. And it gives them free access in many ways, or unfettered access to resources, right, that aren't being put back in state coffers and redistributed throughout society. So those are just things for us to keep in mind, the ways in which these power dynamics also kind of help secure and perpetuate a purely neoliberal approach to governance, right, and wealth generation as well. So I'll stop there and I look forward to the discussion.
Just for my opening remarks, I want to thank the IPS for actually hosting this event to highlight some of the challenges. Really, a critical challenge that the country is currently going through. I think Cameroon is at the crossroads regarding its future, and the Anglophone crisis is putting it at the center. At the core of the Anglophone crisis is a governance challenge for Cameroon, because prior to 1961, within Southern Cameroons, there were elements of Southern Cameroonians who were for independence, and there were Southern Cameroonians who were for association with French-speaking Cameroon, and there were those who wanted Nigeria. So at the end of the day, there was a plebiscite, and we went and associated with our brothers and sisters in French-speaking Cameroon. This problem started after that, and after that is the mismanagement of that arrangement that has led to all the issues that are coming here today. And it has validated some concerns that those who were arguing against this union or this reunion had highlighted at the beginning. At the core of this problem, and I just want to state, is it's not an issue between English-speaking Cameroonians and French-speaking Cameroonians. It's not that, that's not the Anglophone problem. It's an issue between English-speaking Cameroonians and the Cameroonian government. And the Cameroonian government, unfortunately, is predominantly French-speaking individuals. But the average French-speaking Cameroonian does not have a problem with the average English-speaking Cameroonian. A lot of the average French-speaking Cameroonians are also struggling. But the governing body, the governing elite in Cameroon, is where the problem is. At this time today, I'll just highlight that we are 63 days, I think, of internet shutdown in English-speaking Cameroon, just for the record, 63 days. It's the longest ever internet shutdown, collective for, you know, a people because of their heritage. So that's a real, real big problem. The current issue also that have been brought up and started by the lawyers, as Barrister Bobga highlighted, and followed by the teachers, and then taken up by the entire, you know, English-speaking Cameroonians. It escalated because of the fact that government was unable to address it, unwilling to address it, and even if it was willing to address it, was utterly incapable of addressing it. And so it has demonstrated to the whole country, our French-speaking colleagues and English-speaking colleagues and the international community, that there is serious incapability of the current administration to actually address these issues. And the Anglophone crisis is one and a special, you know, crisis because of the historical nature of it. That there is a serious governance challenge that really overshadows all of this. Because there are many who will argue that there is a governing structure that would allow every Cameroonian to feel free within the country to be Quebec in Canada, and not feel as though you are totally disenfranchised in the country. There are others who think that, you know, they were cheated in the past and they should and they have the right and the law would back them to be independent. All those forces exist. But the current crisis today and the management of the current government has sufficiently demonstrated that this crisis is a national crisis that really puts Cameroon at a crossroads. So we cannot also look at this crisis outside the context of colonial heritage, and not an issue of the French citizens, but the dominant structure of French government or the French involvement in this part of Cameroon. But at the bottom line is all Cameroonians, English speaking, French speaking, want to be able to have the opportunity to elect their own government, elect their mayors, elect their governors. They want to, and as you know, some French-speaking mommy I met in Cameroon said, they want to speak in French. It's fine, but folks in the English-speaking region, they want to speak in English also. So if I go to pay my taxes in the English-speaking side and I have to fill the forms in French, that, I mean, for me, it's not as difficult, but can you imagine like a 60-year-old trying to do that and who doesn't speak French, doesn't do any of that? So we have to look at how we move forward in this context of the greater governance challenge and the fact that lots of folks are hurting. The Anglophone issue is very peculiar in its historicity, and to deal with that by itself will be also a difficult thing.
Thank you. Thank all the panelists for their brevity. Is that the word? So let me just, if I can throw a couple of questions out myself, and then we can open it up for everyone else. And I'm hearing a lot of common threads in what people are saying. One, I think it's acknowledging there's a term that I'm going to throw out there that's like the elephant in the room. Everyone touched on it, but we didn't apply this term to it, neocolonialism. And so we're looking at not only the interest of the ruling elite, the power structures, you call it, the, you didn't say power structure, but the French government and those who benefit from it, but then also those outside of Africa altogether, the French and also the West. And some of the history that you were unfolding or contextualizing, even the international institutions like the United Nations had a role in causing some of this confusion. So given that, and I think Kwame Nkrumah once said, Kwame Nkrumah, the first president of Ghana and Ghana's independence, said, seek ye first the political kingdom. And that being what he was talking about was, one, we go for the political independence of our countries, but then also acknowledging that the bottom line is also economic justice and actually trying to be able to have this principle. Like, we want the right to vote for our own leaderships, all those kind of things, not just simply to have it, but also to be able to control the situations and mitigate the conditions that have been wrought by colonialism, poverty, all those kind of things. What type of economic models, what type of forward, you know, thinking in terms of this, this should be embedded or is or should be embedded in the movement that kind of has a foresight once we gain economic control, whether it be, you know, a succeeded English Cameroon or even something, you know, outside of that. What are we looking at here when we look at the greater context of Cameroon and Africa? Does that make sense what I'm asking?
Yeah, yeah.
Anyone, I should do you want to go first?
Yeah.
Please.
I think 65% of our problems arise from the political economy that comes from neocolonialism. France, for example, has Cameroon as its sphere of influence. And the absence of a legal foundation of our union is, and then the vote, which Dr. Ikome mentioned, at the United Nations, harbors this intention. France and all its former African colonies voted against Resolution 1608. Not because, I mean, this is the flip side of it. I would argue as lawyer for Southern Cameroon that, but on the face of it, they didn't vote, so they didn't want us. But the flip side of it is that they did not vote because they had a different concept of what Southern Cameroon was. As far as they were concerned, Southern Cameroon was a territory to be recovered, not a territory to associate with in a federation. And they made sure there was a conspiracy between the French establishment and the English establishment to let this happen. There's still a lot of room for research on the truth about the things that preceded our independence. One of the stories that live witnesses have told us is that Southern Cameroon found itself in this situation not because Britain did not know how rich Southern Cameroon was in minerals. It actually had invited, before the plebiscite, a professor of geology from University of Witwatersrand, who did the survey and said, hey, apart from Zaire, there's no other disproportionately rich country like Southern Cameroon. And that is the reason why Britain tried to use Endeli to get Southern Cameroon join its bigger sphere of influence, Nigeria. When they failed, they decided to blackmail us in the United Nations that they got somebody to redo the survey. And the survey said, we're too wretched, we're not viable enough to stand as a nation, and they were not ready to babysit us. In fact, Foncha at some point requested for an extension of the trusteeship, and it was rejected. So with this, you see clearly that France played its game. And even as we speak, I give you one example in Bafaka, between the town of Kumba and Bongé. There is gold being mined by private interests who are connected to the establishment in Cameroon and the establishment in France. And they have about four cordons of security guards, elite force of the army B, then the ordinary army and the police. The villagers cannot get to that area, but the gold is being harvested. Helicopters fly in and carry the minerals out. So you find a situation where the oil, for example, the refinery in Limbe, which is, I mean, Victoria for us, the gauge can only refine oil from Nigeria, which is of lower quality than the Cameroonian crude. So the crude from Cameroon is sold in advance, but we buy crude from Nigeria and refine in Victoria. But it's a deception because the oil is found in West Cameroon. We are not using it, we export it upfront, and then we buy lower grade crude from Nigeria and refine. And all this is controlled by France. The complication is that in international politics, you have the question of spheres of influence. Cameroon, including Southern Cameroon, is a sphere of influence of France, and it is recognized by United States and Britain. Britain did all this in exchange for a strategic military island around the Falklands, because they had greater interest in the Falkland Islands. So these people just play us like chess. And bottom line is that the establishment in Cameroon is supported, particularly from the colonial agreements of military protection, that whatever happens internally or there is an external aggression, France is there to back the government. That is why we cannot even think of going the military way, as some people have suggested, because it's a game you lose from conception. So the influence of neocolonialism, because all those people who are ruling Cameroon, they are just puppets. They have the identity of being Cameroonians, but their administrative and governance soul is directed from France. Imagine that our foreign exchange is deposited not with a bank, but with a French treasury. And one had expected that with the coming of the euro, this equation will disappear, but France is still holding on to it.
Yeah. I think that was an excellent detailed analysis of how colonialism operates in the country. So I wanted to let's tease that out on, because actually this is also a condition all the time. And so when it begs the question, we see how difficult actually true independent self-determination is for Africa. But can we answer the question? Can we put more on in terms of not just talk about what is and why it's difficult? Is there a way forward? Is there something out? Can Cameroon be an example for something that helps bridges? Like, you know, for example, if you were to have control over your, you know, political independence, real political independence, what type of policies would you implement that alleviates the conditions of? And then you talk about resource extraction, who controls?
Say something.
Yeah, anyone.
Say something.
You can both go.
Yeah, so I think, you know, there are folks who are going to look at the glass as half full or half empty. You know, I look at it as half full. I am optimistic. Because if we look at French influence in Africa, you know, Francophone Africa 20 years ago, 10 years ago, and today, no one can say that it has remained the same. I think the trajectory is that it is decreasing, it's not decreasing as fast as we would want to see it decrease, but there is a trend. I am hopeful for Cameroon because Burkina Faso did things that we could not believe that Francophone Africa could do. And
with Sankara.
Yeah, the same Burkina Faso with Blaise Compaoré and the French Francafrique network. And in Burkina Faso today, a lot of the things that Southern Cameroonians or Cameroonians of English speaking expression and a lot of French speaking Cameroonians are also looking for, it's what believe me, you see in Ouagadougou today. There is still French influence, but at least as of today, as of last 2 years, Burkinabe can go on TV and talk about whatever they want to talk about, and I quote, without being visited at night. But today, a Supreme Court judge in Cameroon was sent back to prison without any charge. Today, a former, bâtonnier of the barreau summoned to the gendarmerie with no reason whatsoever. This is the bâtonnier who is defending, Barrister Mbala and other folks in the consortium. But today, so I think this is a fight which is a long fight. Excuse me. It's a fight which is a long fight. But I have hope in a few places in Senegal. Senegal gives hope to Cameroon. Ouagadougou, Burkina Faso gives hope to Cameroon. Benin gives hope to Cameroon, where we have the new Beninois president, Talon. Talon is changing a lot of the ways administration as we know it in Cameroon is done. Right now, you don't have to be giving gifts and all these corruption things that we all do, that the administration perfects in Cameroon. The Beninois president cuts all of that out, and he's within his Benin, he's Francophone, and under French influence. But at the same time, he has the guts to tell the French company, Balloré and his company, which control our seaports, tell them we don't want you in the port of Cotonou. So there is political will when you are backed by your people. And there is also the fact that, yes, the French will find ways to remain dominant within their sphere, but I refuse to accept that we have to kick out the French for us to actually make progress. I think we have to get to the position where we make our decisions and invite the French in and consult with them. And that's what countries are looking, but you still have spheres of influence for a very long time. We want to be able to, as of now, I look to Burkina Faso and say, I'll be very glad if tomorrow every Cameroonian can go on TV and say whatever he or she wants to say without being afraid of anything. I'll be very glad if, there's that freedom and you can go into parliament and defend, issues and actually start investigation of anything you want without it being controlled. So there is that's my perspective on this. I am hopeful of trends that are taking place in Francophone Africa, even if it's not as fast as I would want to say.
We cannot undermine the reality behind the shadows of what is happening in Francophone, French-speaking Africa. The English-speaking Africa, they have greater liberties to do certain things, establish their own system of government. You see that there is a lot of progress they are making despite the overall neocolonial environment. You can see that in Kenya, you can see the advances in Nigeria and in Ghana, but something is wrong when it comes to the French-speaking territories. This can only change through a popular revolution. It can only change through a popular revolution and leadership. Leadership that will be ready to pay the price. Now, in the 1960s, after the French lost their war against Algeria and Indochina, the War of Independence, they thought that they were not going to lose any wars anymore because they wanted to keep their territories. And so Jacques Foccart, the CIA boss or the hitman, the man who terrorized all the territories to impose the will of the French on everybody. He made a statement to the French president by then, who was De Gaulle, and he told him that since they want independence, let's give them black governors. So that was the philosophy behind the so-called independence. So they had to make all those, instead of going into wars like they did and failed in Algeria, they proposed a pact to all these territories and told them, well, you can sign this pact and we don't need to go to any war, we give you independence within the French community. So that independence was actually enslavement for life. Because under this so-called independence within the French community, their money will be minted by the French for life. And 85% of their currency will remain in French treasury. They only have right to 15%. And anything above 15% will be by a loan. All the minerals under their the soil belongs to the French. They cannot contract with any other nation to extract them. Commerce is primarily to be with the French. Now, so they agreed on all these things. They signed that colonial pact, which is right there underneath. When you see the leaders behaving like some morons, not knowing what to do, because these pacts were enforced by every means. It meant all the poisoning, killings, all the coup d'etats that you see. I mean, virtually every Francophone country, there is either a war or a rumor of war. And the wars are going on until they have gone past the new cycles. Don't talk about them again. They are forgotten crises, like in Central African Republic, like in Chad, in Congo. They are just there killing and killing because these pacts have to be enforced. Democracy is good for the French, but not in French Africa. They never intended there to be any democracy because, so now here's the thing we are dealing with. There are two solutions in Cameroon. One is a solution to save the whole nation of Cameroon, including our Southern Cameroon and the La Republic du Cameroon. It is, if we can go back to the two state of equal status, if we can go back to that federation of a two state of equal status, this is what will happen. Then a new state will be created. It will be called the Federal Republic of Cameroon. And the pacts that the French had signed were signed between the French and La République du Cameroon. So those pacts will not be binding on this new nation. If we can fix it, if that could be an option, that means if the people were still of the mindset that that could be a good option, if that could happen, then that is how to pull out this nation from the French dominion. Then the other thing is we have an option that the rest of Cameroon don't have because we came into this voluntarily by an act of a political action, and that we have an option to pull out instead of trying to fix it for everybody, because the laws of the United Nations support us. We have legal reason, legal arguments to support this, and we can easily pull out, and we come out of the French dominion. We'd rather be under the general neo-colonial domination of the English, which doesn't hold us by the neck, and we can survive.
Okay, I think that's a good time to jump in. So yeah, lots of key issues on the table. And I think we bring this back to the question that Netha asked, right, about the ways in which we can envision an economic system which actually does control resources substantively, right, and focus on those issues of redistribution. It begs the question, if I take the last contention that my colleague put forth, right, this idea that you can have two completely separate nations, right, that there can be some kind of sovereignty movement, that doesn't fundamentally answer the question of resource access and distribution and representation within governance. And that is really the key issue, because even if you do separate, which I'm certainly not at all encouraging, I think it makes sense for Cameroon to stay as one one nation state. But even when you do the separation, you still have those same fundamental challenges with power dynamics, right? And so what we need to be thinking about, I would argue, is to figuring out how we can fundamentally address those issues. And then when that happens, you have people not only buying into the idea of the state, but contributing and even being patient with this process of political inclusion, right? So I'm not necessarily using the term democracy, because that is certainly can be loaded and contentious, but this idea of substantive representation by your governance structure, which you choose through your own sovereign decision-making bodies, is really what's fundamentally key. And if we think about Cameroon and we look at the legacy of we also think about the Democratic Republic of the Congo and Patrice Lumumba, and part of what he really argued, because of course the Katanga province and the DRC is the most mineral rich area, right? And so at one point they wanted to secede from the rest of the country. And, you know, he really pushed this idea of not only maintaining inclusion, but he recognized that having that separation actually, again, serves the neoliberal economic structure that's in place, because by dividing people, you're able then to have the resources be controlled externally as opposed to internally. And so that's, of course, I'm sure what led to Lumumba's eventual demise, but this idea of nationalizing resources, right, can be really, really critical. And I think that Lumumba's experience of the DRC, and then also to the issue of former countries that were colonized by the French, not necessarily politically being engaged or focusing on liberation, I would also take exception to that argument, because as my colleague to the right mentioned, certainly we can look at Burkina Faso and the fact that the ideas of Thomas Sankara, again, this idea of nationalizing resources so that everyone has some access equally, it has certainly been a movement that's taken shape, which has been very progressive. And then we can think about what happened in Senegal, right? Again, the youth were very instrumental using hip hop artists, actually. So the ways in which culture and political participation intersect and can really generate substantive change, eventually, you know, really put enough pressure on Wad for him to step down peacefully. Right? And so I think that there are lots of lessons and examples in countries that were formerly colonized by the French when we talk about substantive democracy and political mobilization that we can certainly look to. But that fundamental question about the locus of economic control or the type of economic structures that we can institute that can, bless you, reverse some of those trends, some of those tensions that were exacerbated throughout the period of colonialism, which, and the goal was just efficient resource extraction. We can address some of those divisions, I think, by considering the ideas of maybe nationalizing particularly energy resources or mineral wealth, which we know is certainly quite lucrative, but then if it's distributed equally throughout the country, then it helps to kind of quell those periods where groups might feel that they're being disenfranchised, and it also prevents the government or the state from trying to create any divisions in order to stay in power, because then they're staying in power because they are representing the interests of the people and they have their support, as opposed to trying to use divisive tactics by politicizing social identity categories, whether it's language, whether it's ethnicity, race, whatever other constructions individuals might, or the state might select at that time. And then you can end up having real substantive change, because if you potentially take that approach, which of course Lumumba and others, Mume as well, have put on the table at different periods and points, then you're also able to take that revenue stream, which allows you to be economically independent, and then start focusing on, you know, public-private partnerships, redefining what your private sector and what your private space looks like. It doesn't mean that it has to be a replica of what you see in the United States or in Northern European countries or Western European countries. But you have the autonomy and the ability to make those choices because you actually control the resources. And that's really critical, because anytime there's a crisis, if there is tension, if there's any kind of civil strife, the majority of the time, that country has some type of mineral wealth or you know, they have oil wealth or there's some kind of commodity that's present there. And so creating division, creating instability allows external forces to come in and, you know, prioritize their own national agenda to the detriment of the sovereignty and the domestic priorities of the state itself and its people. So I would just argue that those are the kinds of things we need to be, you know, challenging, questioning, and really teasing out a system or a structure that works best for that particular context, and not feel that we're bounded by just having to, you know, adopt one model or another model, but we have the ability to create our own models. And I think that should be the primary focus.
Thank you. That reminds me of a Cuban term. The Cubans say, on our own terms. You want to deal with us? On our own terms. For sure, foreign investment. On our own terms. So anyway, I'm going to open it up now. And I know other panelists, you still have more to share. So don't feel constrained by things. We got to keep teaching them, but we just got to open it up. And I hope that we can also get in, because one of the things that I heard coming out, I think from your statement, definitely Adrian's, is the role of youth and women and other marginalized sectors of the population in terms of the movement building, because I think there's a lot to be said about inspiration and foresight, insight coming from those populations when they're involved in the mm-hmm. movement, youth and women in terms of actually thinking boldly and outside of the box. And so maybe, I don't want to ask any more questions because I think I've overstepped my thing, but hopefully some of that will also be teased out. And so let's open it up. And I believe, I don't know, Ronson, you can correct me if I'm wrong, there's a platform for those of you who are online to be able to type in a question or something like that.
Yes.
So please feel free to do that. And if, let's get a show of hands of people who want to make a statement or a question. Please be very concise for the sake of time. Unfortunately, we won't be able to go much over. Yes, sir. And then you.
First of all.
Oh, wait a minute. I'm sorry. Him and then you. This gentleman, is he? I was just recognizing whatever hand I saw, but I didn't. Go ahead, sir. Sorry.
I would like to thank you for organizing this forum. I think this is the first organized by an American institution to talk about the Anglophone problem. And my question goes to Barista Bobga. I think in this room, you were the last person to have contact with the Francophone establishment. You
were part
of the negotiations with the minister,
right,
the prime minister.
Right.
What kind of mindset did you find with them when you were talking? I mean, do they have a full understanding of this problem? Were there people who were interested in looking for solutions? And in the way the Francophone ministers identified with the issues, was there any difference in the way their Anglophone colleagues in government identified with the issues at stake? And second question will be that of leadership. While there might be unanimity about the problem, there seem to be discordant voices about the way forward. And at a certain point, as a lawyer too, I'm sure you run into problems with your colleagues.
Yes.
Justice Stebbins right here, many people might not know this. At one point, he declared independence.
Mm-hmm.
We have you out here in the diaspora, and you see different approaches from different groups. So what importance do you attach to leadership when it comes to struggle?
Okay. Let me start with the first arm of your question. The government, let me say the Cameroon establishment, has a position it does not want to move away from. One of the things I experienced was that during the negotiation, the ad hoc committee to deal with the problems of lawyers, the way they constructed the items for discussion on the agenda was to suit government's concept of the problem. And I told my colleagues that we have to raise a preliminary objection. And the way I did it, I did a table. I put the issues that came out of our resolutions of May 9th after the inaugural conference of common law lawyers. Then I put what the government had put as items for discussion, and then I put a correction to tie with those resolutions. and they were all rejected because the government has its position. They do not consider that there's anything like Southern Cameroons. As far as they are concerned, the question of Southern Cameroon had been long settled. We are, as Bia says it, we are one and indivisible, and anybody attempting to tamper with this indivisibility conceived by him is putting himself online to be tried and punished for treason. And this is exactly the charges that have been brought against my colleague who were arrested. The silence of the Constitutional Council on the petition that I filed is also an indicator, because we don't have an independent judiciary. The president of the Supreme Court has to make a call, maybe not even to the higher Paul Biya, he has to make a call to the Secretary General of the Presidency. How do we handle this? In fact, an English-speaking judge of the Supreme Court did tell me that he visited the president of the Supreme Court because they had judicial recess. And he told him, we have a hot potato in our hand. He said, sir, what is it? He said, some crazy fellow has filed a petition here questioning the union. And we are caught up because we have to respond to this. I wish I were not presiding over the Supreme Court when this thing came in. Another point is that, and this I could hear from my colleagues and the other panelists, the Francophone, ordinary Francophone in the street has been brainwashed that the Southern Cameroonian is a lesser citizen in the Cameroon setup. So even in primary school, you have a filthily dressed child who is Francophone, he's looking down at a cleaner Anglophone child. And the whole idea of bilingual schools is to, you know, adulterate our system. I had to pull my daughter out of St. Albert College because of the violence that the Francophone children were perpetrating there. And because they have the money and we don't have the money, they bring their children, and most of our best schools now have about 45 to 65% Francophone population. So you have this replicated everywhere. If you have you come to a region, the delegates of various ministries will, in worst case scenario, I mean, in the best case scenario, you will have just about 20%, 30% Anglophones in the Northwest or in the Southwest. The rest have to be Francophones. And they are also raping our land. If you go to Bamenda, the whole of Bafungemba Forest, the Bamlikis made sure they had a governor who was from the West. They had the SDO from the West. They had the DO of the subdivision from the West, the surveyors, and the land registrar. So each Bamliki man who had four wives and about 20 children, they would apply and get land allocated to them in government area, to the extent that they have built there and they asked for the Minister of Territorial Administration to give them a chief who is indigenous to them. So Mindankwe has a third class chief who is not a Mindankwe man. So there is a fine, an unwritten policy of assimilation that is being pursued. I think we cannot open up this, you know, because everything you want to touch is actually a whole day's discussion on its own. The question of leadership, I think it is still more of an internal issue. And I think we should take the lead from the Policy Institute and organize another forum to discuss that, because it's actually the most frightening thing, because we will end up worse than South Sudan. So the challenge is for us to take the cue from here and discuss the leadership issue as an internal matter.
I want to welcome all the panelists and thank all of you for being here today. But my question was, knowing how embedded the French is in Cameroon, especially when you're looking at the resources that the country has, how does this Southern Cameroonian independence come into play? Because obviously the French aren't going to just allow this amount of resources to just disappear. That's your bread and butter. So how, I mean, I'm trying to understand how they're going to let that go, given the situation in Cameroon, whereby no one really has a grip of, power is one of those things in Cameroon that the common citizen doesn't really know what it's about.
Yeah, I think we have an idea. As at 1985, at least I was studying in Nigeria, and I knew that 75% of French investment in Africa was in Nigeria, in the automobile industry, Peugeot, and in the mining industry. So what we have to understand is that we need, as Nefta said, to be ready to deal with any of these colonial masters, because it is not Britain that is even better. But we can renegotiate. We assure the French that we are going to do business. As he said, the Cubans say it, but on our terms. So when the French are assured that we can still do business, they already have grip of Southern Cameroon. And I want to tell you, some people from within the system had spoken to me and said, look, you people forget about this independence issue. Let's talk about federation, because the French will be more comfortable that their interest in Southern Cameroon will not be compromised. And my reaction to him was, in Nigeria, I mean, when the first time that the Nigerian president went for his medical checkup in France, it was an issue in the public debate. But let me assure you, the problem is the fear of Southern Cameroonians with a different political acculturization where freedom of speech, freedom of opinion thrives, becoming infectious on the French population that just goes like sheep, literally, towards authority. I think that we can negotiate, and there are many points of entry. One of us even mentioned that we could pass through the CEOs of the French companies that are here in the United States and begin to open up the corridors for discussion.
I think it's a very important question. So before go to the next one, give anyone else a chance to include anything. But please be very brief, because we actually...
I think our land is being depleted by French companies. You have ELF. I think that's it. Because we produce the oil. The oil in Cameroon, and for the past 40 years, they have been exploiting that under the colonial pact that they have with our other federated state, La Republic. So in my opinion, I think that there is no act of union, and therefore we have this. If we sue these companies to court, we can obtain an injunction in international courts, because whoever they sign agreements with to exploit these minerals, they had no right, they did not own what they gave them, because unless they will show an act of union that give them rights to that territory, to have been able to sign pacts and agreements to exploit our minerals. So we have a legal fight we can fight. If we are organized, we can win that fight. We can at least obtain an injunction. Or since there are the powers behind the French system in Cameroon, they will now prevail on the government in place to kind of have a negotiation or whatever, accept some of our demands, so that they should not just, as they do what they have been doing for 40 years, they take all the minerals, there is nothing left in the local communes or counties or local government. They have no taxes to pay locally. They just steal it, actually, and take it straight to the French. They don't even refine it locally for us to see it. It just leaves from the sea to the French metropolis. So we have a legal fight. I think we can address that while we hope to have some political independence to take eventual control over this.
All right. So I'll just add that. No, so at the end of the day, our history is what it is. It's our history. We had 1961. We had 1972. We are here today. Everybody in the Northwest and Southwest region is supporting, you know, this fight. The question becomes, this fight is a fight that, you know, is for self-determination. And there are people who want to be able to self-determination. There are folks within the southern Cameroon spectrum who want what they call a two-state federation. There are people who want, you know, a totally independent Cameroon. There is that ban as expected in any vibrant society. So that's the first thing to highlight. The second thing is how we go from here, as we talk about negotiating with internationals, has to do with how we may think that it has to do only with us. Yes, it does. To a certain extent, we have to bring other partners into it to get on the table. But at the same time, I would ask a question to everybody in this audience. If somehow in Cameroon today, as an English-speaking Cameroonian, you are able to, one, feel free in your country where you are, speak English and French, elect your own governor, ask questions to your administration as to how the oil money is being used, your elected officials respond to you, your daughter goes to school and can choose to go to school in English-speaking school or French-speaking school, and you will not be arrested without an arrest warrant. Would you call that Cameroon an independent Southern Cameroon, or would you call that an independent Cameroon? So the bottom line is that this fight is a fight for setting freedoms, setting respect, a respect of the culture, and a respect for the freedom to be able to have a legal system that you trust and that's respected. You know, so that is the bottom line. What structure would allow you and every Cameroonian, I would say this, okay, English-speaking Cameroonian, to do that? Because an English-speaking Cameroonian, we can be quote unquote independent on our own, and then the same political elites play a number on us. It's still possible, but right now we don't see that. But I think the fight is a fight for these fundamentals to be able to make sure that the common law that is with habeas corpus, which just got, you know, messed up today, the freedom to be able to speak your language and stuff is done. So that's the fundamental. How do we get that?
Okay, we want to make sure we have room. So we have one more question. We'll make sure we have room for the closing statements of the panelists. I want it. Who? Mm-hmm. Oh, you have a question? Mm-hmm. Can if he goes for? But I also wanted to make sure Adryan.
I'll just put it in
China.
The closing. Mm-hmm. I'll put it
okay.
In the closing.
Very briefly, I was just going to make a comment. Kevin Giddens, I'm a linguist that works for the Peace Corps, and I just appreciate the conversation and just was noticing the framing of Anglophone, English-speaking versus French-speaking. And as a linguist, we often think of languages as resources. So as you think about distribution of resources, considering those languages as resources to be distributed equitably. And also just to highlight, we work teaching language in Cameroon. Cameroon has 284 languages. So it's just important, I think, to honor that resource as the discussions move forward and see what can be done with that diversity that, that you bring to the world, really, not just
good African languages.
Yeah,
huh?
Yeah,
that's right.
So yeah, sorry.
Oh, thank you. So I wanted to.
I really truly just hammering on what you said with the diversity of language we have in Cameroon. This is truly not an English-speaking versus a French-speaking issue. It's it comes down to the marginalization of people from the two regions. And we normally say, when somebody shows you who they are, accept them for who they are. You cannot marginalize the people for over 50 years. And to add salt onto injury, we are on day 64. We came here because of the title Internet Refugees. We are on day 64 of internet being shut down from those two regions. How more can you marginalize the people? Right? How more can you marginalize the people? All of this, and people think you cannot do this to people and not expect people to come and sit here and say they want to leave the union. You cannot do what you've done for 54 years and expect people to want to live together with you and eat on the same table. We are talking about magistrates, justices being locked up, people voice an opinion and they are locked up. No, it doesn't work that way. That's not what we want. And if you're expecting us to be in that kind of union, tough luck. The other day, the UN was in Cameroon talking about Boko Haram in the north. Do you know how many more people the government has managed to radicalize within the last 64 days? Mm-hmm. A lot of people have jumped ship from being federalists to becoming independent because of what is happening. Sure. This is not how you solve a problem. Mm-hmm. So what, we came here today to talk about internet refugees. My question is, and I would want the Institute to help, how do we get that internet back? How do you help us get back to communicating with our people back home? And for where we are today, 64 days out, look, I've been reading comments online, 99% of people don't want to be in the union. For those who are online, yes, these are people who are online. People who are not online might have a different opinion. But I'm reading what I can see. And that is the feeling of people who are being affected. You don't do this to people for 54 years and expect us to want to stay in the union.
That's right.
It does not work. So please, when we leave here today, I'm hoping that follow-up sessions, one, we need to bring back the internet. One, we need the people who are incarcerated to be released. Before we can even be talking about anything. So those are the sorts of actions we want to see. And please, if people are talking about cessation or separation or federation, or please know that it is out of what has happened for 4 years, and it's happening, and it's not getting any better. And so you are not giving people any reason to say something otherwise.
Okay, so we want to let the panelists do very quick. Can we do less than 5 minutes now? We are missing, so we have to go. So let's just can we start.
Yeah.
We have to close now. I'm sorry. We started late and we don't have any more time. We're over time by 10 minutes. So let's just, sorry. Go ahead. Yes, let's start with you, maybe. Or you want to go the other direction?
What I can say is that you've heard it from those who wear the shoes and know where it pinches. As a lawyer, I can tell you there's no legal justification for the union. And that is why and maintaining the action in the Constitutional Council. The lapse of time has now made provision for us to secure an argument that it is impossible to obtain local remedies, and we intend to take the action to the either the African Commission or the Human Rights Committee. And if you were to, I don't know the survey that has been carried out that Dr. Foretia talks about, but I can tell you, you had an event in the Muna Foundation sometime.
Oh, you had to be canceled because of this, right?
Okay, this was the impression in Bamenda, mm-hmm. that if they heard you talk about that in Bamenda, you were lynched.
Yes.
That's to tell you the level of anger. Mm-hmm. They thought that government had sponsored the Nkafu Foundation mm-hmm. to come and have that sort of discussion.
Yep.
It is a no return journey that the people have made. And we are hoping that when there's third party intervention, we may be able to moderate the feeling of people mm-hmm. and reenact a test period of a properly conceived and implemented union.
Sure.
After that, there could be an evaluation, and that would be it.
Okay, thank you. So since you were very, with 190 seconds, I think maybe I can just assure that everyone else would be 2 minutes instead. Sorry about that. You helped it. So if you can do 2 minutes. Is that
okay? No problem. Here is what Larry, I think they are watching, because they follow us wherever we go. So they should know that they try to destroy our will and the resistance and sent us underground, banned all political parties, and arrested our leaders, killed some of them, but it did not stop us. We tried to change tactics to come out from the underground and change the system through multi-party politics and see how we could bring the change that would accommodate us. They suppressed it. We fought for everything that we even have today that is just common for a human existence. Now, here's the thing. The strike action by the lawyers and the teachers was just in search of dialogue. And now they are rejecting dialogue every step of the way. But let me say this, that there will be a solution. It's either going to be an amicable solution or a violent one. We don't want it to be so, but that is the inexorable path that they have chosen for us. And we as a people, we want freedom, whatever the price.
I would definitely say that, obviously, in terms of the frame that my colleague just mentioned, whether it's going to be peaceful or one that involves more violent action, I think it's fundamentally a question of trust between the people and the government. And so if they want to restore that trust and in a way that's genuine, that would certainly begin with bringing back the internet and opening spaces for critical engagement with the state, and not using suppression, not undermining movements, not recognizing that the strikes that have happened recently are an outpouring, a result of a feeling of marginalization by part of the population. And so the only way for them to address that and to ameliorate it is to integrate people, make their voices heard, and make their agenda a priority, and to give them some substantive representation and to actually address those demands. Otherwise, people will continue to lose faith in the system, and it will make the state likely react with probably more suppression or more violence. So I would think definitely restoring the internet immediately would be a first act of good faith, and then things can move forward from there. But those basic abilities to just be critical and to be able to articulate your opinion are essential to any kind of representative government. So the state will have to respond, I think, in that way. They're serious.
Well, what I would say is, I think, in Cameroon, we have, if we want to be segmental, we have English-speaking Cameroonians and French-speaking Cameroonians. I think I'll focus pretty much on my friends, my colleagues, who are, French-speaking Cameroonians. Because at the beginning of this crisis, the number of English-speaking Cameroonians who were for quote unquote separation was not that many, as Barrister Bobga said. But today, because of what has happened, that number is alarmingly huge. And you know, I would even dare to use Mr. Trump's huge with a Y. You know, it is huge and growing. And I would just challenge my colleagues who French speaking Cameroonians to and look them in the eye and say, these people will get to the point of no return if they don't start interceding. Because I can tell you for sure, the government of Cameroon, the French speaking Cameroonians do not support the government of Cameroon. But if they think that, you know, it is okay for a part of Cameroon to be served out of internet for 64 days, then their inability to stand up for injustices like that continue to show Cameroonians of English-speaking descent that they do not want them. So it would not be surprising then that, you know, English-speaking Cameroonians all of a sudden, because of in the last 5 months, are all for separation.
Well, thank you very much. I want to throw in a last comment. I think when we talked, we all shook our heads when we talked about when I mentioned the term neocolonialism. The fundamental contradiction is this. So, and I mentioned, the brother mentioned, we need to build a movement for a revolution. This to me would include touching the hearts and minds of our people all across the continent to understand this fundamental contradiction. Obviously, if people are confused about what, on the divide of this language, about what general populations want and not looking at the power structures and the elite who benefited from it and all that, then there needs to be mass political education, consciousness raising effort, that then we can inform what is the best course of action to be taken in any given place on the continent of Africa or the African world. I think we have to remember about the fun things with distribution of wealth and those kind of things. And sister mentioned nationalization. When we talk about that, then we really have to know what we're up against in order to actually really make headway in any aspect of that problem. We have to know the fundamental contradiction. But I thank you very much. It was very insightful. I learned a lot from our panelists. I want to thank you for your work that you're doing and also participating on this panel. And hopefully other people got a lot out of this, and maybe we can continue some in the future. I don't know if I'm committing to something or not, but yes, let's continue our work. Thank you very much.